I've got a serious oscillator fetish, I admit it. I've been collecting gear, buying and selling synths since the late 70s, and I have owned more pieces of hardware than I dare to remember. Recently, I came across the ASM Hydrasynth, and the thing just blew my mind. This synth is deep. Its programming capabilities are pretty much unsurpassed. Its sonic quality is incredible. The build quality is excellent. It's capable of so much more than the sounds that you're going to hear just in the factory patches or on some of the videos on YouTube. And there are some really powerful things that they have implemented into the design and the functionality. So I hope you'll spend a little bit of time with me and we'll take a deep dive into the ASM Hydrasynth.
I'm not going to get into the sound sources. There are, you know, wavetables, a lot of them, and a lot of control within those. But because so many other videos on YouTube have covered that, I'm not going to cover that. I'm just going to go into some of the deeper pages of editing and other things that you may not know about that I haven't seen covered in other videos. So the first thing I want to cover is some of the hidden pages, menu pages. So in this case, we have three oscillators. Oscillator one, two, and three at a fifth. So this is the first page of the mixer. You can also control your noise level and rig modulator. The second page, this arrow steps you through. The second page you actually see, you can pan each oscillator separately. The bottom section here is something quite interesting. Oscillator to the filter. So this is the percentage of the oscillator that goes through the filters. And it's adjustable for each oscillator. Can't hear it that well on this patch, but I'll show you another patch where you can. There's a third page. There we go. So the third page allows you to adjust the pan of the ring modulator and the noise. And once again, the percentage of those that is run through the filter stage. So that's quite an original idea there. Here's another sound. So while we're doing that, let's just take a look at that mixer, the lower pages, the hidden pages. There's the volumes, the panning, and then the percentage of each oscillator that it runs through the filter. So if you see, if I turn this, so it's 0% of the oscillators going through the filter. The sound is very different. Going back to that first sound, there's another thing we'll see. If you look in the filter stages here, there's the first page of the filters, but there's this link to the second page of the first filter. When we do that, one of the options is drive. Something quite useful there. So this section up here is called voice, and it handles separate programmable parameters. So first of all, it's polyphonic versus unison versus mono. So polyphonic, mono, and then when you get into unison, the density, the next number here, is how many voices. Up to 8. And then the following one after that is detune. The setting at the end here is analog, and what it does, it actually adjust a bunch of different parameters to simulate some of the less than stable characteristics of analog oscillators and synthesizers. A little hard to hear in this patch, but very, very, very interesting. The warm mode adds a little bit of bottom end overall, warms things up. This next section here is the stereo width. So this determines how the voices that you play are assigned. Anyway, the other section that you find here, the next page in the voice section, is to do with your modulation and pitch controls and such, the parameters of that. Then here on the, whatever this is, maybe the fourth page, you have things to do with the scale. So for instance, is this, the default is chromatic. But there are many, there's 32 different scales. So these are worth checking out and playing with, because you can program different modes, and this is programmable per patch. Let's look at the effects section. If I click on the delay, all of these parameters now change to reflect the delay settings. But more importantly, what I want to show you is I can turn it off so it's completely dry, no delay, do the same to the reverb. So I've turned off all the delay and reverb, but you can still hear reverb. This is a bit of a problem. This is one of the issues that I have that I'm not thrilled with about the unit. The issue here is that these macros that are set up for live performance can control anything. But for instance, this one that says blur is actually reverb. Someone has just named it blur. So now you've got your reverb here. But if you turn it off and you have this blur setting on, you still have reverb. So neither of these is actually an absolute control. Even if you have patches where this says reverb, if you turn it right off, you still may have reverb here. So I find this a bit of a problem for live performance, in that there isn't one control to actually turn on or off or adjust the mix of the effects, whether it's the reverb or the delay. They actually reside in different places. Let's take a listen through some of these effects. Okay, delay. And we've got stereo. Panning delay. These can be either done as time, milliseconds here, or based on beats per minute. But here's something that's interesting. Here you can control the tone of the delay. So as you can hear, that's a high pass filter. It's filtering out the bottom end. And then the opposite, when you go, so there's a low pass filter. And then here you have the feedback tone, which is a different adjustment because it actually changes over time. Let's take a look at listen to some of the other things here. Let's just listen to some reverbs. Dry and wet. You have pre-delay and you have delay time. There's a hall, room, plate reverb, and something they call cloud. Now, once again here, you can control the tone of the reverb. High pass. And low pass. Then, separate from that, you have these high frequency and low frequency dampening. So, you can hear I'm rolling off the high end here. But the difference between this and this is this is actually changing over time. The high end is being dampened over time. Whereas when you use this knob, it basically it's just a preset for the whole thing. Do the same here for low frequency dampening. Now the delays, something you know, very, very useful, very interesting, all programmable. And then you have the times. That's 6 seconds. 21 seconds. Thirty-five seconds. And you can actually use a freeze function. So that will stay and sustain like that unless you cut in one of the dampeners. In which case, even the freeze dies out. So very powerful reverb. The next thing I want to look at is something that is really interesting and not even mentioned in the manual. But for this, I'm going to look at the envelopes and the LFOs. But this, what this does is these settings of the envelope 1 through 5 and LFO 1 through 5, all of these settings are indicated by the flashing lights behind these buttons, which is really helpful when once you understand that. You'll see this first LFO and envelope. You can see there's fine little lines here connecting them together. It's because LFO 1 and the envelope 1 are assigned automatically to the filter. They're hardwired. Envelope 2, LFO 2 are hardwired to the amplitude or the amplifier section. And all the other ones are programmable through the modulation matrix. In this patch, I'm focusing on the LFOs. You can see how evident it is that the first LFO is responsible for that ticking sound. The second LFO is assigned to pitch. And this third LFO, which is going really slowly, is actually a panning LFO. It's just really easy to see from the feedback that you get from the lights which LFO is doing what. In this next patch, I'm focusing on the envelopes. Another thing they've implemented on the ASM Hydrasynth are these things called macros. With every Hydrasynth patch, you can program 8 macros. Each one of these knobs and switches is a different ability to interact with the sound, to transform it, to modulate it, to manipulate it. But the interesting thing is each one of these can have multiple parameters assigned to it. You could have one knob that affects one parameter in a very subtle way as you twist it, another one in an extreme way, and even a third one in a negative value. There, you can completely customize these macros. So for each patch, you have 8 abilities to manipulate things in real time, to make the item more expressive, more interactive. Let's just play with one a little bit. Thank you. I'm just going to call up another patch and we'll just see what we have set up for macros on this one. So you'll see they're very effective in transforming the sound, manipulating and modulating it in real time. So shift provides access to a bunch of different parameters depending on what you're doing on the synthesizer, where you are. It can be certain things like if you are working on settings, for instance, wave lists. If this allows you to pick which waveform you want. However, if you hold shift as you turn this, it will update so that all of these waveforms are grouping, starting with this number and going up. So it's a quick way to change 8 different things at once. If I hit shift and browse, all of a sudden, these 8 are favorites, as in 8 presets that I've selected to be able to access quickly. There are 4 pages of that. So let's just take a listen here. Page 2. So once again, direct access to 32 of your favorite sounds. And here's another thing that you can do using the shift button. You see how hard it can be to dial in an exact number in this ratio. As soon as I hit shift, it goes up in single values instead of decimal points. Let's take a look at the envelopes, for instance. You hit the envelope, you can have an attack time of 36 seconds. You can also have a delay. You can have a hold. The decay time can be 60 seconds. So as you can see, these envelopes are well beyond what almost any other hardware manufacturer does, aside from going back to like a Yamaha DX7 or something that had these incredible envelopes. But anyway, that's very original, very powerful for doing ambient or sound design stuff. The other thing I want to mention is this thing has polyphonic aftertouch, which is very expressive. And even though it's becoming a little more popular on hardware, not a lot of keyboards have it. Very useful, once again. And add to this the fact that you've got the polyphonic aftertouch. You've got these macros, but you could also plug in an expression pedal. And you have CV and gate inputs and outputs. So the ability to even expand this in terms of its expressive capability is really rare and really valuable. I'd like to talk briefly about a few of the things that I think either are problematic or could potentially be changed. First of all, the macros, they're very powerful, really wonderful ways to customize your control for performance or improvisation. And you can spend a lot of time and energy defining these macros because they are so powerful, because you can have multiple parameters affected by each knob. The downside is that you can't copy and paste these from one preset to another. So if you spent a bunch of time coming up with 8 killer macros that you want to use live, and you start a new patch, you can't import those. You can't copy and paste them. You actually have to recreate them. This is somewhere where if they had a software editor, it would be great. You'd be able to drag and drop and copy and paste all of your favorite parameters into different patches, which right now is not possible. Here's another thing. You're working with something. You do some sort of modification to it in any way. And then if you like it, as soon as you go to save it, the sound cuts out. Very frustrating in a situation where you're in a live performance type environment and you've modified a sound and you want to save that for later reference, and you can't do that because all of a sudden all your audio comes out. The other thing that is a real problem for me is this display. The display is so incredibly small. If you don't have great eyesight, it's very, very difficult to read the information off this in terms of the text names. If you were playing an outdoor festival where there's bright sun, I think this would be completely lost. Even in a club or concert type venue where you have a lot of light, I think it would be both because of reflectivity of the glass as well as the size of the text. It's quite a concern. This shift button is wonderful and really powerful and used to set parameters all over the synth. But one downside is you always have to use a second hand to adjust it. It'd be great if they could assign that to a foot switch so that while you're doing something, you can step on a foot switch, activate that additional level of control, and then tweak your parameter. Some of the other things that bother me are pretty minimal, but this is the desktop version, which is designed to be rack mounted. If you had this item installed in a rack mount case with a bunch of other gear, all of the patches, the plugs and jacks are around the middle in the back, which is great for patching within your rack. However, the headphone jack is there as well, which to me is just ridiculous. Headphone jack should be on the front here somewhere where you can access it, because once installed on a rack, you'd never be able to get there to plug anything into it. As I said at the beginning of the video, ASM has really done something very unique, powerful, and exciting with this piece of gear. It is so inspiring to play. It is a very personal instrument because it is so diverse in the way that you can set it up and the different types of sounds that you can get from it. You could use it for so many genres of music, and it really has the ability to be personally expressive, of course, because of all its abilities in terms of expressiveness. It makes it a great instrument for experimental, explorative things. I hope you get a chance to put your hands on one of these pieces of gear, because it's very exciting.